Yeah, dear students, in this module we will look into the contribution of ancient Greek, Roman and Chinese thinkers in terms of the population theories. Specifically, we will discuss about the demographic scenario in the early centuries, Confucius and other Chinese philosophers' contributions to population issues. We will also look into the contribution of Greek philosophers in terms of population issues and the contribution of Roman philosophers to population issues. So, this module will provide us comprehensive understanding about the thinking of various philosophers and great thinkers about population issues. Let us start with the demographic scenario in the early centuries. Since the ancient times, scholars as well as thinkers were concerned with population size and population growth. These thinkers and scholars started expressing their concerns, expressing their views about the population size as well as population growth. And these thinkers and scholars were from various countries and cultures. By that time, all the cultures considered population size to be the nation's strength and nation's wealth. That kind of positive thinking about population size was noticed in the early centuries. The population size is considered as national strength for army, and it was also considered as national wealth to get revenue. One has to understand these two aspects. The feeling at that point of time, or the perception at that point of time, was that if you have more people, you can have larger army. If you have more people, you can generate more wealth through revenue. So, these two were the benefits of having a larger population at that point of time across the various cultures. Strength of army and revenue were fundamentally dependent on the supply of able bodies to fight the enemies and to work hard. If you have more people, if you have more able-bodied people, then they can be deployed in the army, and the strength of army gets a powerful tool for the country to win the battles with the enemy countries. The second aspect was about having more number of people who would be working hard so that more revenue gets generated. Often population was growing very slow, or in some places and then at some times of point, at certain point of time, the population growth was even negative. The population was growing at a very slow pace, or sometimes even the population growth was recorded to be negative. This kind of slow or negative population growth was attributed to large number of deaths. That time, the population was suffering from non-communicable and communicable diseases in the form of epidemics or endemics. It was also known that large number of men were dying in the wars. Therefore, the cultures favored the population to grow. And for this, marriages as well as childbirths were encouraged by the cultures. However, since the 18th century, communicable diseases were slowly being controlled. And as a result of the efforts to control the communicable diseases, the number of deaths started declining. This trend of change in the mortality pattern resulted in steady growth of the population. The deaths were declining. As a result of that, the population started growing. As we know, the population growth is a function of deaths and births. And if the number of deaths start declining, you will have more number of births. As a result of that, the population would grow. That was what observed during that time when the mortality was controlled. This kind of demographic change was considered in a positive way by some scholars and thinkers, while some of the scholars and thinkers considered this kind of demographic change in a negative way. So, the scholars and thinkers were having positive as well as negative opinion about the kind of demographic change that was taking place. Some scholars considered that growth in the population was desirable because the population growth helps the nation to become strong and also helps the nation to become a wealthy nation. On the other hand, other scholars and thinkers considered the growing population as a factor contributing to increased poverty and also sometimes leading to war, famine and epidemics. The scholars and thinkers were mainly concerned about the population size, which was an integral part of formulation of public policies on political, social and economic issues. And of course, for supply of military as well. Some of the scholars thought was that the population issues, some thought that was driven. Some of the scholars started giving importance to population related issues in the earlier period. Of course, some of these statements cannot be considered or designated as a theory of population. Population theory is considered to have emerged only in the 19th century, when the work of Thomas Malthus was published. Let us now look at the contribution of Chinese philosophers relating to population issues. Some of the ancient thinkers and philosophers noted the impact of population growth on levels of living, internal peace and productivity of the workers. The Chinese philosophers, scholars and thinkers thought that the concept of optimum population in relation to food production and limited land needs consideration. That is a kind of an expression about the available resources and population growth. They also considered population growth in relation to the available resources and possible checks on the population growth. It is worth noting that many of these thinkers and philosophers were in favor of population growth through encouraging stable marriages, strong family bonds, and higher levels of fertility. Now let us look at the contribution of Greek philosophers. In the Greek political life, individuals were only a part of the state, and the individuals had to play a subordinate role to the state. These viewpoints can be traced in their social institution of marriage and childbirth. Sparta is a warrior society in ancient Greece that reached the height of its power in the 5th century BC. This culture was centering around the loyalty to the state and military service. In this culture, marriages were part of legal and political system. The Spartans were expected to marry and procreate children so that the state would have a constant supply of persons for the army needs. Repeated war expeditions decreased the population size and thus demanded constant supply of men. High fertility was encouraged, and couples with 3 or 4 sons were publicly rewarded in this society. Population was encouraged to get able children. As a result of this, deformed babies were eliminated. Celibacy was discouraged and made punishable by the law and denounced in the public. Male Spartan citizens were allowed only one occupation, that was joining the army. The focus was to have a large contingent of army. The boys entered into military training at early age of 7 years. The Greeks also encouraged abortions and exposure of newborn babies, leading to infanticide in times of rapid population growth. The population size was considered only for defense needs, like security of governments, than from that of economic resources. Plato's reference was only to citizens or army and did not include women, children, and slaves in the ideal population size. Plato also recommended 2 ways to solve the problem of our population. Number 1, infanticide by exposing or abandoning deformed infants, and by colonization. Plato recommended high fertility through rewards to the couples with many children and ridiculing and failing in their duty to achieve certain family size. Plato thought that marriage was a means of having many children. He also recommended that females to be married between the age of 16 and 20, and suggested that marriages should be made compulsory for the girls. Plato also recommended immigration in case of decrease in the population. Aristotle, who lived between 384 and 322 BC, was of the opinion that overpopulation would give rise to poverty and other social evils, since it was not possible to increase the land and property as rapidly as the population size grows. Aristotle suggested abortion and exposure of babies as preventive checks. In order to control the overpopulation, Aristotle also proposed that couples should have small number of children. The Greek and Roman philosophers' thinking about population issues differed considerably. While the Greeks thought about the population size according to the sustainability of city-state, the Romans thought that the population size in the context of conquest, power, and empire. Therefore, Romans supported population to grow. For this, the Romans granted certain privileges to the married couples with children on the one hand, and by taxing and disinheriting non-transferable property, those who did not get married or those who did not have children. In this module, we looked into various aspects and the thinking of various scholars and thinkers from China, from Greek and from Roman cultures. We looked into various aspects relating to the perceptions of the scholars and thinkers in terms of population growth and the need for population growth and the efforts to ensure population growth. Many of these cultures supported population size and growth for the security of the nations. As we discussed, the thinking at that point of time was that the nation should have a large and strong army so that the nation can win wars against other countries and other nations. In view of this, many cultures were in favor of larger population size. That too, the emphasis was on strong and able bodied men so that all of them can be deployed in the defense forces. The emphasis was on men rather than women and children. And in some of these societies, the boys were enrolled into the defense forces at an early age of 7 years. The cultures also felt that population growth is required to supply to the army and also to work and contribute to the revenue generation efforts of the nation. So, two vital aspects here. One was the strength of the army, the second one was the financial strength of the nation. And the feeling was that more and more able-bodied men should come forward to be part of the army or to work hard so that they contribute in terms of revenue. The Chinese scholars and thinkers favored population to grow. They were also in favor of growth in the population. And they advocated and propagated population growth through stable marriages, strong family bonds, and high levels of fertility. The Greeks, the scholars as well as thinkers, were in favor of population growth. The purpose behind such kind of higher population growth was the constant supply of army. The Greeks also were in favor of having a strong and large contingent of army to win the battles for the nation. For this, they propagated and they encouraged marriages. They also initiated rewards for the couples who had many children. This is a kind of an incentive for the couples to have more number of children. They also were in favor of these incentives, such as giving punishment to the people in case they do not get married. The Romans, on the other hand, considered the population size in the context of contest, conquest, power and empire. The Roman thinkers and scholars also were considering about population with relation to the power of the nation and empire, power of the empire and expansion of the empire, winning the battles. These were the vital aspects considered by the Roman thinkers and scholars, and they were also in favor of higher population growth. Thus, we have seen that across the cultures, the thinking and the perception about population was that higher population would always help the nation and help the culture and help the country in terms of strong army and higher revenue. In view of these two vital aspects, many scholars as well as thinkers across various cultures and various countries were in favor of larger population growth. It applies to the Chinese, the Greek, as well as the Roman philosophers. We also looked into the demographic scenario in the early centuries. We looked into the perceptions prevailing at that point of time about the population size and the growth of population, and we also looked into the aspects about the low levels of population growth as a result of higher levels of mortality and higher levels of casualties in the wars, as a result of which more and more men were dying in the wars fighting for the country, resulting in higher levels of mortality and reduction in the population growth. We also looked into the importance given to marriage and childbirth across the cultures. We also looked into the perceptions about the implications of larger population or implications of population growth in terms of poverty and wars, famines, as well as epidemics. Some of the scholars felt that larger population would lead to higher levels of poverty, while some of the scholars felt that larger population would lead to more number of wars, while some of the scholars and thinkers felt that larger population would lead to more famines. On the other hand, some of the scholars and thinkers felt that larger population would lead to epidemics. Thus, the responses or the concerns expressed by the scholars and thinkers vary widely across the cultures. However, majority of the scholars and thinkers were in favor of larger population size and higher population growth, and some of the scholars also felt that population size should be considered from the dimensions of formulation of public policies. These include political, social and economic policies of the country. Of course, we also have seen that the population theory can be considered to have emerged only in the 19th century with the pioneering work from Thomas Malthus that was published. So, this module has helped us to get a comprehensive understanding about the perceptions of various philosophers, scholars and thinkers about population, population size and population growth. Thank you so much.